All right. Welcome. Let's see, everyone here. We're missing a couple of people. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23. Almost. Almost everyone. All right, so let's see. So the last couple weeks, with last couple of lectures, I believe we've been playing around with Angular, and you know, first playing around with hitting a third-party API that gave us access to their database through some Node.js or some JSON API, right? That provide they hit their own databases and provided data to us through a URL that can be configured, right? You provide the configurations and, you know, it uses the configuration parameters to hit their database and return data. And we want to be able to replicate that functionality, that feature, right? I believe last week we started playing around with Node.js and, you know, I downloaded and installed Node.js on my local machine and I showed you just a couple of ways that we can create certain web services. Yes, we saw that it was pretty easy to use Express as a mechanism to create web services, right? You can map a URL to a function, and this function you could do whatever server side logic you might want, and then respond with JSON. All right, I believe that's what we did last week. Is that what we did last week? Okay. So the next step, well, the next couple of steps would be first be able to hook it up to a database, right? And then obviously you want to be able to host it somewhere in a live server, right? And so I'd like to cover those two topics. Maybe it's a little too ambitious. Maybe we'll cover one and half of the other, and we'll finish up on Wednesday. But at least get you going with hosting something online. I believe I've asked you to get open an account in OpenShift. And that's where we're going to be hosting the Node.js and the MongoDB database. It's a free site. If you keep it simple, right? If you keep your simple server or simple database, it's free. Once you want to make it for real and want to make it for many users, a real production environment, then perhaps you might want to upgrade to a paid version of the service. Right? But for this course, it's plenty. It's plenty what the OpenShift provides us. Okay, so let's see. I believe I've asked you to go to OpenShift. And this is where I asked you to go to, right? We go to OpenShift, and did you have a chance to open up an account in OpenShift? Anybody? I see most of you opened up an account. I opened up a toy account. Anybody tried creating an application? Anybody had a chance to play around with that? Okay, I see a couple of you. So I wanted to demonstrate how to go about that. Let me remove one of these applications. Let me remove this one, for instance. So I'm not gonna need this one. Delete it. I'm gonna start one from scratch. Something else that you're going to need, you need to be able to publish these things, right? You want to be able to work locally on your machine, yes? You'll test your environment locally on your machine. You'll hit your own local database. And then once you feel comfortable with the local version, you would then push it to the server. Pretty much what you're doing with the .NET version of this course, right? You have a local server running on your machine, you have a local database, I'm not sure, and you're testing all this locally, and then you want to publish it so that other people can see it online. Same thing here. Now, the way OpenShift works to be able to publish your code works with Git, right? Anybody have play around with Git? Anybody play around with Git? Right. If you haven't, it's definitely a good idea to start working with Git. You can download it. You can download it from here. Here we go. So if you go to Git downloads, they have it for Mac OS, Windows. Download the Windows. It's just executable, right? It runs. It installs locally a couple of commands. One of them is the Git command. Okay, and the Git command will allow you to be able to post or publish your things to OpenShift. So real quick about Git. Git is a distributed source control environment, right? You know, maybe you're familiar with some other source control environments. Visual Source Safe is one from Microsoft. Turtis is one of the clients that many people use. It's an open source also. There's quite a few open source solutions out there. GitHub is one of the more popular one. GitHub. And to be able to interact with GitHub or one of these open source source controls, you need Git. Git is it has a local copy of your source code, right? And then you're able to publish it wherever you say you put a URL, and then it publishes it to that URL, right? To that Git URL. Okay. So we're gonna use Git to be able to download whatever the application from OpenShift, right? Change it locally and then publish it back to OpenShift. Okay, that makes sense, right? The other thing you need to download and install, which I hinted at last week, is MongoDB. MongoDB. If you go on MongoDB, you can download and install a version of this database. Now OpenShift is going to have its own MongoDB instance, right? Which is going to be hosted online. Yes, again for free if you keep it small. But you want to be able to replicate the environment locally in your machine, right? To do local development. Once you feel comfortable with your development, then you publish your application online, and it'll use the online version of the database, right? The only cumbersome thing here is that the local copy, because it's local, you have you can do whatever you want, right? Very little security because it's running locally in your machine. Okay, you can set the port, you can set the IP address, which is listening. The remote version, right, is configured to run at a particular port at a particular IP address. Yes, so you need to finagle your source code to be able to run on both environments. You have to be smart enough to know, oh, I'm running locally, so I should use these ports and these IP addresses, or I'm running remotely, so I need to use these other ports and these other IP addresses. So that's the only thing that might be a little weird, right, to get it to run on both environments. Okay, so so definitely I would encourage you to download and install Git. Right, and get familiar with if you go to this website, Git SCM, right? There's quite a lot of documentation that you can go get through and get you going with using Git. Okay, we're gonna use the absolute simplest, the most basic Git commands. Right, basically is get the status on your local Git environment. Right. On your local Git repository, source repository, see if there's any changes. If there's anything new that you need to send over and publish it, you're gonna commit. You're gonna add files, right, to the repository. So Git is aware of all these new files that you've created, right? You're gonna commit. Perhaps giving a simple comment saying, my first Node.js application, and then you're gonna push. Right, it's going to push it remotely to the OpenShift repository, and the OpenShift repository will restart your server, or you deploy all your files, restart the server, right? So you can see your changes online. That makes sense, right? All right, so let's create a very simple OpenShift application. All right, so let's see, where are we? All right, where do I have it? So I had a website here, OpenShift. Oh, wait, here it is. Okay, here it is. I'm going to create a new application. Here's the one that I was playing around this morning. I'm going to call it CS561002. Okay. All right. So this has everybody been able to come to this? It's basically your dashboard where all your applications are right. And there's an add application. Has everybody has been able to see this button where you can add the application? If you log into your OpenShift account, right, you should be able to go and add your applications. Once you click add application, there's quite a few types of applications that you can host in OpenShift, right? So you can host a lot of Java applications, right? You can Drupal, WordPress, you can host PHP applications. There's quite a few, but there's all sorts of web applications that you can host here. Ruby, Python, there's quite a few, right? We're going to be using this one, Node.js. Okay, Node.js over here. Right, if we click on that, it'll tell us, well, what do you want to call it? Okay, what do you want to call? Now, notice this URL that at first, my first application, it asked me for a namespace, right, where I was going to be storing all these. For me, this was a kind of like a throwaway example, right? So I gave it just a bogus name, JGA123. This used to be an input field where you could type the namespace, right? For you. For this course, a good namespace, for instance, might be CS5610, right? And then under that, you can have several applications, right? So this would be your application for dash, CS5610, right? So application one, application two, application three, right? For this course, one application is plenty. Okay, one application is plenty. I'm gonna call it CS5610-02. And I'm just going to say create application. So what this is doing is copying a template, right? It's creating a directory and it's creating a template application and under a dedicated directory for me, right? And setting up any configuration that it needs for that particular server, and it's starting the server. Now what it does is that this is the actual location of the application. If you ever want to be able to actually log in and see it on the remote server, you can actually log into the remote server, right, and see the actual files you're deploying. But you can use a git command to clone it into your local environment, right? You want to pull down all those files, all those template files that OpenShift creates for you. Right? Because you want to modify it. I want my application, right? It creates a Hello World application, right? And what you want to do is bring down that Hello World application, modify it, and make it into a real application, okay? So to clone it down, right, to copy it down, we're going to use this git command that's listed here. Right, there it is. I'm going to copy it. I'm going to copy it, and I'm going to go into my local environment. So here I have under the directory Northeastern CS5610. Under there, I'm going to paste my git command. There it is, git clone. What clone means, right? Download all, create a directory that matches, right? This Git repository that is online being hosted by some other server, okay? It's going to pull down all the files, going to create a directory called CS5610-02, right? That's the name of the repository. That's the naming convention that OpenShift. Notice that if I do an ls here, notice that there is no directory CS5610-02. There is a CS5610-01 that I was playing around this morning, making sure this worked. Okay, so let me paste that. Let me copy that again. I'll paste it. Say yes, I want that. It says, are you sure? Yes. I was going to pull down, I'm going to do an LS again, and notice that now I have CS56-1002. See that? Right? If you go in there, and so in LS, this is a copy of what OpenShift has is hosting remotely. Okay, this is what it's hosting remotely. So let's leave it here for a second. All right, let's not do anything yet. Let me go back to here. And what else does it say? And this, it gives me a couple of things, right? If you wanna add more files, right? If you wanna make any changes, right? What you do is that if you have new files, what you would do is git add dot, right? From that home directory, CS56-1002, yes? If you have any new files, we might not have new files, not yet anyway. Whether you add files or you just changed existing files, either one, whether you add or you change, you have to commit them. You have to say, all right, commit my changes, right, dash M, if I have a message, right, if I want to, you know, put a small comment on what it is that I did, right? And then git push. Git push will start copying any changes that I have locally. It'll push them back to the server and we'll redeploy and restart the Node.js server. Make sense? All right. All right, so we should remember those commands. We should perhaps copy this just in case anybody, if we want to clone it later on, I'm just going to copy it here. Let's see, what else? And maybe I'll copy this cheat sheet. Just paste it here just to remember that I need to do that. Okay, so let's see. Continue to application overview page. So I'm going to go here. This is kind of like the dashboard for my application, the application I just created. Okay? If I hit it, right, here's the URL is down here. There it is. You know, cs5602-rhcloud.com. If I click on it, it's going to be a boilerplate template application, right? That OpenShift has created for us, a little documentation. So this is the default page, right, that OpenShift creates for us. Okay? We're going to blow it away. We don't need it. Right? It's garbage. It's not useful to us. Okay? We're going to replace this with what we want. Okay? But it says, you know, so there's some useful information. There is a command line tool that allows you to do some setup information that which we're not using. Here's some reminders on how to use the git clone and copy things over locally. All right, so this is running. This is running. We want to be able to change this and do what we want. What we're going to be using mostly, we're not going to be using it for hosting pages, right? To host pages instead, we're going to do that in our .NET server, okay? You know, our HTML, our ASPX, our content is going to be in the .NET server, okay? We're going to be using Node.js mostly for showing you how to create web services, right? How to do RESTful service. What we did for the weather application, we did a couple weeks ago. Was it last week? No, the week before. What did that do? Was this thing, this server running on the cloud, right, waiting for URL queries, right? And that those URL queries responded with JSON, right? Okay. We want to be able to do the same thing. Okay. Make sense? All right. Okay. So let me go back. Let me go back to my application. One other thing that I would like to add to this. One other thing that I would like to add is MongoDB. I want to add the database to this, right? Right. If I click on add MongoDB, again, from the main page of my application, I can also add MySQL or Postgres. You know, there's several types of databases you can host. One of the more interesting ones, I'm sure you already are familiar with relational databases, right? Using SQL and select statements and right. The more interesting one that perhaps you're not as familiar with is MongoDB. Okay. So let's play around with something that we don't know anything about. Let's do this. Let's add the cartridge. So OpenShift calls, you know, a server, it calls it a cartridge, right? A database, it calls it a cartridge. Okay. What it does is that, you know, to maintain a limit on what you can install and what it can offer you for free. It says that you can install up to 3 cartridges, right? Also with some limits, right? And that's how it offers free things, right? It limits what you can do, but at least these two things are enough for us to build something or something interesting. So let's add the cartridge. This is a NoSQL database. What we're going to do is that we're going to have this running remotely on our machine on OpenShift, yes? And we're going to try and replicate the same thing locally on our machine, right? And then, you know, do our development locally. And when we feel comfortable with our local development, we're going to push it so that it can be accessed remotely. Make sense? All right. Okay. So is that here? So there's a couple information here. Let's look at this. It says the database has been successfully added. We have a username admin, a root password. The database name is CX561002, and this is a connection string. This is a little misleading, but it's close enough. The connection URL is a little bit more involved. Let's copy that, and let's copy here into our cheat sheet over here. What else? What else do we need? Something else I'm going to add, and it's something another gear I'm going to add. It says that it has 2 cartridges installed, right? Node.js, and I just added MongoDB. Okay, I'm going to add one more thing that is also free, right? Which is a client. There's going to be a MongoDB client, right? Just like you you have Toad is a client, yes? Right, to that you can have a client to MySQL or SQL Server or Oracle. You have a client that you can interact with the database. RockMongo is a client to MongoDB. Make sense? Right. This is going to allow you to interact with the database. Right. See if we've been able to insert things. We've been able to update things. Make sense? All right. Let's do that. Let's add RockMongo. You say okay. Yes. Adds a cartridge. So it's adding Mongo, there it is. And I'm gonna copy this too as well from RockMongo into my cheat sheet. Okay, there it is. All right, now we have 3 cartridges. That's the limit, right? OpenShift doesn't want us to use more than three cartridges. Okay, everybody okay? Everybody still with me? All right. Okay, so let's see what we downloaded. You know, what we downloaded from OpenShift. Let's take a look. I'm gonna open for Northeastern and 605610, and there it is. This is the directory that was created when I cloned OpenShift. Yes, I want to run this locally. So let me open that. There it is, server.js. See that? I'm gonna copy that and leave it so that I can always go back to what I had originally. I'm gonna open server.js. There's quite a few things in here, right? One of the things in here is require express, right? Remember we did express last week? I believe we did that on Wednesday, did we? Did we not? But they have a pretty involved version of using express. Notice that they're also using some environment variables such as IP addresses for OpenShift, Node.js port numbers. There's quite a few things here. I'm going to blow this most of this away. I'm just going to blow that away. Right. Instead, I'm going to use one of the templates that I can get from Express. Express. That's not it. And we're using the 3.x version. And I'm going to copy this over. I'm going to copy what we had, the way we started last week. Remember? Right, we did this very easily. Right, we copied this and I'm going to paste it here. I'm gonna run this locally, see if it works. Okay, let's run it locally. Let's see. So Node, I have a local version of Node. Remember we talked about last week about installing Node. We did that already. Another thing you should start downloading and installing is MongoDB. Okay, perhaps some of you already have done this, right? You copy, execute the executable and install a local copy of that. So we're going to run the server here. We're going to run server. There it is. If I run it, it's running. Well, no, actually, no. What is it complaining about? Express. I don't have Express. Locally, I don't have Express. Do I? I don't. What about node modules? Let's see what's in node modules. I have .git keep. So we don't even have Express installed. What do we do to install Express? NPM, right? NPM install Express. So let's do that. So NPM install Express. Let's run that. So that's installing Express locally. Now, remotely, this works, right? Because they have their own version of Express running, right? But it might not be exactly the same version that I'm having here. I want to make sure that I have exactly the same environment that I have locally that they have remotely, right? And make sure I keep track of those differences, right? Like the IP addresses and the port, and make sure that I deal with those successfully, right? Okay, so let's try that again. Node server. It looks like it's listening. All right, let's try it out. Let's go to a website and let's try and hit it. So it's listening at 3,000, I believe. Yeah, it's listening at 3,000. And so let's hit it. So localhost 3,000. It's hello world, right? And that hello world is from where? It's from here, right? So this hello world. Sorry. Go away. This hello world over here, meaning if I hit the root, the slash, right, it's going to come back with hello world. You're just going to send text. And just to make sure that we do have the right server is running, goodbye, hello world. Okay, let me make sure. I'm going to stop this. I'm going to refresh. I'm going to rerun the server. I'm going to hit the service again. Yes, it is, right? So that is being handled by that slash there. Everybody okay? Yes? All right. Not do that. I don't like that. Okay, so we want to be able to do the same thing. I want to push it, right, remotely to the remote server and have this working. Yes? But for this to work remotely, I need to look at what they send me. Right. This was the original server that JS that they had, right? Well, in here, there's a couple of clues that we need to keep track of. For instance, one of the things that we need to do is that they have an environment variable, right, on what the IP address and what the port number should be, right? Since I'm running locally, I can do whatever I want. I can listen to any port, right? Well, as long as it's 127.0.0.1, which is localhost, right? As long as I use those combinations, I'm good, right? But if I run remotely, I can't do that, right? So I'm going to copy these environment variables. I'm going to copy them, right? I'm going to copy them here, and what I'm going to do here, I'm going to say var my IP address, var the port number. I'm going to say or, meaning, but this is going to look at the value of this process.environment, the environment variable. If it exists, it's going to use this. Right? If it's undefined, right, meaning it's not there, it's going to use whatever I give it here. Okay? So I'm going to say use 127.0.0.1. Right? If there's no
such thing as this environment variable, that means you must be running locally. Right, and if there is no port in this Node.js port in OpenShift, it must be that you are running locally. Right, and I'll use the port 8080. Make sense? Right.
Now in my listen, I can tell it both things. I can say the port number as an argument and the IP address. I can listen to that IP address at that IP address at this port. Okay, let's see if this still runs locally. Right, if I run locally, I refresh, Oh, that didn't work. Oh, okay. Sorry. I changed the local port number to 8080. All right. So let's try 8080. There it is. Hello world. Okay. So we are still running locally. Let's try this remotely. Let's push this to the remote server to see if this works remotely. Okay. So let's go here. I'm going to stop that. I can say git status. Remember, we use git clone to bring down everything from OpenShift, right? And we have a clone of what we have in OpenShift. I want to know now if something has changed, right? So I can run git status. It'll say, yep, the following, oh my goodness. Can't see that, can you? Well, somewhere this says that server.js has been modified. I have a couple of new things that Git doesn't know about. It says you have a .bin directory under node modules and you have an express directory under node modules, right? And you have this new server copy, right? These three things I don't know about, right? They are not in the repository. They are not being tracked, right, by the code repository. Yes? So we want to add those things to the code repository. It says, yes, I want to add it. So we're going to do git add dot. Dot means add everything starting in the current directory. You know, just recursively go through the entire directory, right? Looking for things that are not in the repository and add them to the repository. I say that it goes through that. So all the files, right, recursively and adds it to the repository. If I say git status again, it's going to say all these are new files. Now the status is all these new files are being added to the repository. Okay. I can now commit my changes. Hello world. So those are my changes. The A means add anything else that might be there, any changes that might be there. M means that I want to add this message, right? I want to tag this commit as hello world. Okay, this is useful if other people are also using the same repository and they can see what other collaborators are doing in the same repository, right? So I'm going to do that. Okay, so it's been committed. Now the only thing left is to push. Before I push, remember the remote one, the remote server, where was it? Where did it go? Did I leave it? Oh, there it is. There it is. There it is, right? If I click it, notice that we still have the old page, okay? Right? We haven't done anything. I'm going to push. While you're pushing, it's going to stop the server because it's going to reboot it. It's going to restart the server. So for a blink of a sec, for a blink of an eye, the server will be down. The servers will be unavailable. All right? So usually you might have two environments, right? One maybe for development, one for production, right? Or one for testing, maybe one for development, one for testing, and one for production, yes? And then once you feel comfortable with development, you push it then to testing, right? So people can bang on it and make sure that they test it. And when once they go through their testing, then you promote it to production, right? Here, we're doing everything, right? We are development, testing, and production all in ones. So I'm gonna do a push. So it's going to stop the server, right? So for a couple of seconds, it's not going to be available. Notice that it's stopping the application CS56102, stopping it for a second and rebooting the whole thing and copying all the files. So if I go here and refresh, oh, it's already working. Okay, it already restarted. It was very easy. So notice that it's the hello world, right? The same hello world we had locally, right? So this is remotely. And this is locally. That's remote. That's local. It looks the same. Okay. So what we want to be able to do, right? Right. Any questions so far? Any questions? So ideally, I can work locally, right? Make sure that I can hit the database. I can create things, remove things, delete, update. Yes. And once I'm happy, I can promote it and publish it. Okay, so let's play around with that. If you remember, we could create JSON just as well, right? You can say get, you can say, you know, I don't know, some JSON. Using what? The response, from the response, I can say .json. So I can send back an object, right? A JSON object. Now this object, ideally, is some object I'm getting from a database. Yes? So I, over here, I can say hello, colon, world. Right? I'm going to start locally. Wait, do I have a... Wait, the server here locally is not running. Oh, okay. Yeah, it's going to time out. Okay. I'm saying, how's this working if it's not running? I'm going to start it locally, node server.js. We have the same behavior. Now I just added here some JSON, right? I created, and there it is, hello world, right? So that's working. So what we're going to be able to do is retrieve data from a database, right? Instead of this hard-coded data, we want to be able to insert, we want to be able to retrieve, update, delete things from a database, okay? All right, so let's do that. So to do that, we need a database, yes? And as I said earlier, we're going to be using MongoDB as a database, okay? I installed it, right? I went here, I went to downloads, I went to Windows, I downloaded it, and installed it locally. When you install it locally, it creates a directory. Let me show you. It creates it. I believe it puts it under program files. There it is. So under program files, it creates MongoDB 2.6 standard. Right? If you go in there, okay? There is a bin directory. If you go into that bin directory, there's a couple executables here, okay? One of them is the actual database, the daemon, right? MongoD, right? That's a server, right, that you're going to leave running, right, indefinitely, listening for incoming requests to the database, okay? The other one, this plain one that says Mongo, right, that's a client. Right, that's going to allow us to interact with the database, right, and do, you know, it's very much like you would use Toad for, right, to do, you know, queries, you could do updates, you could do inserts, deletes, right? All right, so one of them is the server, this one, right, and the other one is the client, right? And there's several admin tools that allow you to do some maintenance work on this, right? Maybe restore database from, you can import from other places, you can export data so you can transfer it. Make sense? All right. One other thing is that you have to remember is that you have to give it you have to give it a place, a directory, where to store the data, where to store the database, right? By default, it looks at it at the root C, right? Data DB. Right, so under this directory is where it stores, right, all its data. Make sense? Everybody okay? All right. So I can start the database from anywhere. So let me start from here. If I say MongoDB, all right. So what I did is for all these executables. I took this path. And I put it in my path, right? So that when I can type MongoD or Mongo from anywhere in my command line. Yes? Okay. So here it is. If I type MongoD, the server is running, right? The database is running. And it says that it's listening at this port, 27.0.17, the standard port. Okay? Right? I'm gonna minimize it. I can connect to it from my I started it using what? MongoD. That's how I started the server. And to connect to it, I'm going to use just plain old Mongo. Right? So here, I can type Mongo from anywhere, again, doesn't matter. I type it and it connects to the server, right? Certain things that, you know, I mean, there are a lot of commands, right? Well, we're only going to do some very, very simple commands, right? One of them is I can show all the databases, right, that are available. So show DBs. So there's one of them that I was using for this class, CS56101. Once you have a list of databases, you can say, I want to use CS56101. Okay, let me, now that I'm in that database, so now, sorry about that. Now that we're in that database, so this is pretty much very similar to all relational databases, right? You go, you choose a database, and then in there, what else would you do now? You want to look at tables, right? That's what you would use in a relational database. In non-SQL, non-relational databases, right? We don't talk about tables, we talk about collections, right? Collections of things, sets, right? Which more or less what that's what a table is, right? It's a collection of things. So it's a collection of records, right? And we don't call them records in a NoSQL database. We call them documents, right? Each record, we don't call it a record. We call it a document, right? So let's see in here. I can say show collections, right? So I only have two collections. One is the one that MongoDB creates for me for indices. The other one is another table or collection I call applications, right? Which I can look at the content. So that's the equivalent of a table. If I want to list what's the content in this table or collection, I would use in a relational model, I would say select star from applications. Yes. So the equivalent command here would be db.applications. Find. So find means find. If I don't tell you what, that means I'm not telling you a where clause, right? It's like if I say select star from applications and I don't give you a where clause, what do I return? I return all the records, right? Same thing here. The where goes inside of these two parentheses, right? I'm not giving it a where clause. That means it's going to return everything. All right, so I have four records. Sorry, excuse me. Four documents. I have four documents, which is the equivalent of a record, right? So I have four records. This is a test. This is a application chest, checkers, EE. So I was just playing around. I was just playing around putting stuff in here, right? We want to replicate something similar remotely, right? Being able to hit a database, okay? So let's do that. Everybody still with me? Everybody still with me? Okay. All right. Okay, so... I want to be able to do this not here from the command line. I want to be able to do it from my application, right? From my web application, yes? So I want to, instead of me hitting here db.applications.find, I want to be able to do that programmatically from my application, okay? I want to be able to do something like that in my server, right? I want to be able to do something like that over here. I want to be able to do db.applications.find. I want to be able to do something like that here, right? And then once I have the data, maybe I want to render it or something, right? Maybe I want to send it back to a client, maybe an Angular client, right? That receives a JSON and it renders all the applications. Make sense? Well, that's what I want to be able to do. All right, how do we do that? Well, to do that, we're going to need a driver, right? We're going to need a MongoDB driver so I can use it from Node.js. Right, so Node.js, we're going to install a driver. There's quite a few that are very popular. One of the ones that is very similar to the exact syntax used by Mongo itself, right? One of the that's very, very similar to the way we interact with, you know, using at the command line with MongoDB is MongoJS. MongoJS. MongoJS, there's a website for that, and you can find it here. I don't want to leave that. I here you go to MongoJS. There it is, MongoJS. So here it is. It's available in GitHub, although you can install it directly from NPM, right? We can install it directly here. Let's stop the server. Where is it? Where's my server? I hope that's not what it's recording. I hope that's what's recording. anyway, where's my server? Let's see. Is that my server? Okay, I'm going to stop it. I'm going to install now the driver, right, to be able to talk to MongoDB from my Node.js web application. Yes, right? So I'm going to do npm install MongoJS. Oh, so now it's installing the driver so my Node application can talk to MongoDB. Okay. Okay. So it's installed. Let's look at the documentation for MongoJS, how to use it. Let's see. To use it, we need to require MongoJS. There it is. So I'm gonna require it. Let me copy these two lines of code. I'm gonna copy it in my. I'm gonna say. There it is. I'm gonna say.
Siri not available. Connect to the internet.
Did I say Siri? No, I didn't. Quiet. What was I saying? Okay, MongoJS, there it is. Require MongoJS, sorry about that. and the connection string, I need to tell it where is Mongo running, right? Where's Mongo running, okay? If Mongo is running locally, right? The only thing that I need to do is tell it the name of the database I want to use. Right, if I'm running locally, okay? But we're gonna be running remotely, right? We're gonna be running on this Node.js running on OpenShift, yes? Okay, and in OpenShift, it's gonna have its own port, it's gonna have its own IP address, right? Okay, so we're gonna need to finagle our way for this to work remotely, okay? We'll do that in a second. Locally, I just wanna use CS 56.10.02. That's going to be my database, and I'm going to have here we tell it what collections we want to use, what tables, right? What tables we want to be able to use. The names here are going to be useful so that later on I can use it as attributes in this dot notation, right? So here it is. So I'm going to say I'm going to use applications or employees. Say employees. Okay. Once I created this DB equal MongoJS CS 5610, I can now use DB to do all sorts of things, right? I can now connect to employees, right? And I can insert into the database, right? I can create an object. I can say var Alice. So Alice is an employee and has a first name, Alice, and has a last name, Wonderland. Okay, and has a salary. Right? And I can do an insert. I can say, I want to insert Alice. Now all this communication from our Node.js back to the MongoDB server, it's asynchronous. Okay? Meaning it's not going to stop Node.js from maybe listening in for other incoming HTTP connections, right? It should be asynchronous, right? Because otherwise, you know, if the MongoDB server is kind of lagging or waiting, right? This would have to wait, right, to come back, and that would not be good because we might lose, you know, queries, you know, this very important a query, right? And we're not going to be able to answer hello world, right? Because we're busy listening in for a reply from MongoDB. Right? So these are all asynchronous. So the way we are notified, the way we're notified, MongoDB comes back telling us that, hey, yes, it was successful. It's good, right? It notifies us by calling us back. We're going to provide a function for MongoDB to reply to us, telling us everything's okay. Or if something went wrong, it'll pass us some error message. Okay? All right, so it'll pass us some error, maybe data. And we can display here, we can console log the error. Here we go. The error, and we console log the data. Okay? So let's do that. Let's stop the server. Stop the server. Oh, it stopped. There it is. Node.js. I'm going to do it again. I'm going to run it again. Okay. Notice that it came back, right? After a blink of an eye, it came back saying, no, that's what? That's the error, the ERR. There were no errors, right? And it came back with an instance of an object that it inserted, right? This is kind of its way of acknowledging that this is the data that I was able to insert. Notice that I have the data that you gave me, first, last, and salary, plus an additional attribute that MongoDB adds to the object, right? Saying I created it, and I created this primary key, right? That makes this record, right, this document unique in this database, okay? In this collection, right? So this underscore ID, any of the attributes, if you see an attribute that starts with an underscore, it's a managed attribute. So it's an attribute that is being managed by MongoDB, right? MongoDB might add and remove certain attributes for its own maintenance, for its own local inner workings, okay? And notice that we're not responsible for maintaining this ID, right? It creates this unique identifier, although if we want, we can be, right? We could, instead of using this, this very artificial ID, right? We could say we want to manage the ID ourselves, right? Maybe we want to use a social security number or student ID or whatever. Okay. For now, it's easier to leave it up to the database to create these primary keys. Everybody okay? All right. Let's look at what got inserted. So I have here's my console, right? That's connected to my database, yes? And we are using the database, what was it? This one, CS56-1001, right? But hopefully the other database was created. Let's see, show databases. Oh, we have the other one. There it is, CS56-1002. Was not there, remember? It wasn't there, right? So we can go back there. We can say use CS56-1002, and I can say show collections. Here we have the employees collection, right? And we can list all the employees. We can say db.employees.find, right? And that's going to list all the employees, right? Right now there's only one. Notice that it came back and it's one object, the same object that it came back to us, right? If we compare the ID with this ID, right, it'll be the same ID. Okay. Make sense? Right? Let's create another one. So let's create now Bob. Okay, and I want to do Bob. There it is. So I'm going to stop my server. Here's my server. I'm going to stop it. I'm going to run it again. Right, and presumably it inserted Bob. There it is. So I'm going to go to my console again. I'm going to do a find again. The same find I had earlier for my console. Now it says there's two records, right? Alice and Bob are there, right? Everybody still with me? Right? Okay. But this is lame having to do this by hand, right? Having to stop, restart the server, stop. What I want the service to run all the time, right? I want to be able to hit it with a URL from my clients, right? From my Angular client or from, wherever, right? I want to hit it with a URL and then the server respond and then maybe insert delete, update, remove, do things as I control it from URLs. Yes? You know, as I have my URLs, maybe from Angular, do all these queries. Make sense? All right, so let's do that. Okay. So what I want to be able to do is, for instance, I want to be able to do this insert in a kind of like, we did it down here, you know, listening for a query, right? Like this some JSON over here. Maybe we can create our own and say app.get, right? And say, call it, you know, create Charlie, right? Create Charlie and in this function or create, not Charlie, create employee, okay? And here we can have request, response, and put this in here instead, right? All right, so now we want to create one when we do an invocation, right? When we invoke something, we want to, on demand, I want to create Charlie, not when we run it, but when we hit the URL, okay? So let's do Charlie Garcia. Well, that's too much. $1 million? No. okay, so here's Charlie. So I want to hit this URL and it creates Charlie. Okay. All right. So let's stop the server. Let's run it. Notice that it did not create anything. Right? Didn't create anything. Let's go to our client. Let's hit it. There's still the same two URL, the same two records in there, right? Let's create these, hit that client, that local client. And we're going to say, where is it? So create employee. Notice that it's going to stay there because we never answered anything back. You know, we should have. Let's go back here. So presumably this happened. We created Bob with Charlie in there. And we did an insert. Let's see if that worked. Let's go to the database and let's see if made it here. There it is. We have Charlie and Garcia. Made it to the database, but we never responded anything. See, the server never responded anything, right? And so the client, this is kind of still spinning. You see that still spinning, right? So what I'm going to do whilst it still spins, what I could do in our response from our insert, what I could do, I could say response.json. I can send back the data that was actually inserted, right? I'm gonna stop my server and restart it. Notice that's this, okay, this it timed out. The browser timed out. If I run it again, right? If I run it again, it knows that it did not respond last time, right? So it buffers that and it remembers that it says, oh, there was a request, right, that I never responded, right? So it but now it's able to respond, and notice that it's in there, right? So the browser also would say, you know, I timed out, maybe I'll keep trying, right? But if it ever comes back, there it is, Charlie Garcia. It came back, the data came back that I just inserted. Okay, pretty cool, huh? All right, well, what about if I want a list? What if I want a list? Well, actually, before I do that, before we advance, well, this is kind of lame, right? Having to, you know, this create employee only creates Charlie. That's all it creates, right? So every time I hit that link, right? If I do this again, right? If I'm running, and I hit that link again, right? If I hit it several times, notice it's changing 54, 55, right? If I go to my database, to my client, I do a find, I've inserted Charlie quite a few times, okay? Every time I hit that URL, right? Really what I want to be able to do is parameterize this, right? I like to parameterize it, perhaps provide here a query parameters, right? And those query parameters could be used for creating the correct employee. Maybe there's several ways that we can do this, right? One way we can do it is that we can put it as like this. We can say maybe we could say Edward Norton, right? And then the salary. And parse these path parameters, right? That's one way that we do that. Another way that we could do it is that we can provide query strings, right? We can say first equal, let's do it both ways, right? Let's do this one first. So Charlie and Dan. Last is equal to Aykroyd. Is that how you spell Aykroyd? I don't know. And then salary. Maybe he does make a million. He's not dead, is he? I don't remember. First, last, and salary. Right. That's what I want to be able to do to respond. Now, if I do that now, it still matches with the create employee. So I just added a new Charlie. Okay. Well, what I want to be able to do here is in the create employee, I want to retrieve those pieces of information. Right. The way we retrieve it is from the request. That query string is mapped to this object, the request dot query. Okay. So each one of these. The first, the last, the salary. Let's print it out. Well, let's do a console.log query. Okay, let's see what's in there. Okay. And let's run it again. Let's run the server again. Let's stop it. Let's run it again. Let's hit that URL again. Let's hit it. Okay, and let's see what it printed. There it is. That's what it's printed. First Dan, last Aykroyd, salary 23. All right, so whatever we type in here, right, if we go here and say Daniel. Oh, we never did respond. Did we respond? I thought we did. Oh, we did. I'm sorry. It's when you do this, it halts the server. All right, so careful, right? If you halt the server, right, it's not able, you're blocking the console. So it can't print out the console, so it can't continue. It blocks. So careful with that. So there it is, Daniel Aykroyd. So we are being able to retrieve the query, right? And notice that the names of the attributes is the names that we're using in the parameters. See these parameters? If instead I use first name and last name, and I hit it again, there it is, first name, last name. You see that? Okay. All right, so what we want to be able to do here is that the first, what we're going to do the first, we're going to grab that value from where? Request.query.firstname. I think that's what we called it, right? And then the last, we're going to grab it from request.query.lastname. And salary, I think we did call it request.query.salary. Okay. And instead of calling this Bob, I'm just going to call it some generic employee. There it is. Okay. All right. Let me restart the server. Okay. Now, finally, if I go here and do the find, notice that we have no Dan Aykroyd. We have lots and lots of Charlies, no Dan. Okay. But if I hit this now and I do a refresh, notice that it comes back with Daniel Aykroyd, right, and the IP address and the new ID. If I do a find here, notice that there's Daniel, right at the bottom, right. Or we can say first name. We can say Edward Norton, right. And salary probably. There it is. If I do a find, there's Edward. Okay, so we have everything, right? We have everything we need to create employees, right? And put them in the database. Yes? Okay. So the last thing we need to do is, well, not only do I want to insert them in the database, right? I want to be able to retrieve them from a database, right? So we can say, we can create here, not only a create employee, we can do an app dot, we can say a get, and say that we want get all employees, right? Yes. Yeah, no, we'll look at post, put, and delete later on. Yeah. This is showing you what most of the APIs are doing today, that everything's a get. Yeah, everything's a get. I didn't want to get to RESTful APIs just yet, but yes, we'll look at that. So we'll do function request response. And so get employees. Well, what I want to be able to do is retrieve everything from the database, right? And the way we're going to do that is do a db.employees. Is it employees? Yeah. db.employees, employees.find. I want to find them all. I'm going to find them all. And it's going to, I'm not going to filter, meaning I want all the employees. I want to do basically what I did here, right? This is what I'm doing here. See that? db.employees.find. That's fairly the same thing that I'm doing here, right? This driver MongoJS is the one that is closest to what the actual syntax looks like if you're doing it by hand interacting with MongoDB. So if you feel comfortable with the console, you should feel just right at home using this API. Okay. The only difference here is that it does need to call us back with the data, right? This is asynchronous. It'll come back to us with data. So it'll come back to us with some error maybe in the actual data. And so what we're going to do is I'm going to respond back in this URL. We're going to respond with all the employees. We're going to say response.json. We're going to send it back, all the data. If you ask and forget all the employees, we'll retrieve all the employees. Make sense? Okay. So let's stop the server. Let's restart it. So now in here, what we're going to do is we're going to say not create employees. We're going to say we're going to get all employees. There it is, an array, right? Comes back as an array. There's Alice. There's Bob. There's Charlie. Charlie again. Charlie again. Right? All the Charlies that we had inserted, right, are there. Charlie, Charlie, Charlie. There's Daniel, and there's Edward. So it's an array of objects, okay? Makes sense, yes? Another thing that I might want to be able to do is retrieve not all employees, but retrieve a particular employee, okay? If I know, for instance, their ID. But for instance, what I could do is retrieve this, render it as an Angular table, perhaps, yes? And when they click on the delete button, right, I know their ID, I know the records when I created them, right? Remember that Angular stores the object, right, for each one of the iterations, right? So one of the things that is stored is the ID, right? So I always know the ID. So if you click on deleting in a particular row, I'll know the ID, right? So I can always send you the ID that I want to delete, yes? So for instance, what I might want to be able to do is app.get delete, and yes, like your colleague said earlier, instead of .get, we could do delete, right? But that would complicate my example. I don't want to get into it just yet. Delete employee. Oh, no, not delete, I'm sorry. I'm going to get an employee, right? Is that what we said we would do? Yes, get a particular employee. So get employee, say, by ID. Okay, by ID. And I have function res. So this would respond how? This would respond, I need to provide an ID. Yes? One way that I can provide an ID is to say, for instance, the URL, this is the URL. I could do this. I could say ID equal and then the ID. I could do that. Or let's look at the other way that we could do it, right? The other way that I could do it is by passing it as part of the path, okay? I could pass it, again, as a query, or I can pass it as a path, right? Either way, it's fine, right? So I like to be able to pass the ID here, okay? So what we have to do here is that we have to give it, I have to map this URL pattern. This would be a new URL pattern, right? That's a new URL, right? I'm going to map it and say, I'm going to pass you the ID here. So this matches /string/string. Okay, actually, I'm sorry. It matches /getEmployeeByID /something. All right, whatever that is, okay? I am gonna call that ID. It's gonna map it to ID, right? And to get that, we retrieve it like this. We say var ID. We can get it from the request dot params. Instead of dot query, is dot params, okay? Params dot ID. Now, this name is a local variable, right? The name doesn't matter, okay? It's just a local variable that I'm copying. Actually, I don't even have to copy. I can just use that instead, right? But I just wanted to do a console.log just to show you that we can retrieve the ID. And maybe we'll do a... and do an ID here. And so let's stop the server and restart it. Oops. What the? Okay, there it is. So let's try and hit it. So get employee by ID. Oh, I didn't respond, did I? I didn't respond. So it's just gonna stay there. But in the command, notice that it, in the console, it did print out get employee by ID and you know all that garbage that I typed, okay? So here, I might respond something. Maybe let's do a response JSON with an empty object or an empty array. Let me stop the server, let me restart it. It's gonna respond. There it is, the empty array. All right, the browser was waiting until the server responded with an empty array. Okay, everybody okay? Everybody still with me? All right, so instead of this empty array, I wanna retrieve my data. So it's very similar to this, but I need to filter, right? If it's by ID, MongoJS has a call for that. Let's go to MongoJS. I think it's called find by ID, find one. There it is, find one. Right, there it is. I'm going to copy that. And I'm going to paste it here. Okay, so DB my collection. What's my collection? Employees, right? Find by one. And notice that it has an object. See that object? It has an argument. It has two arguments. My find only has one argument. What is it? It's a function, right? The function of how it's going to reply. How the database is going to reply and passes the data, whereas this one has two arguments. The first one is the filter. It says, I don't want all of them, I want one of them, right? And how am I retrieving that one? By the ID, right? I can do it by first name, by last name, by whatever, right? Now, what about if last name, if I filtered by last name, but it's Garcia, it matches tons of them, yes? This will retrieve the first one that it finds, okay? Notice it has an ID here as an example. I'm gonna blow that away. I'm gonna use as an argument this ID here. There it is, I'm gonna paste it in here. Notice that it's inside of this mongojs.objectid. See that? All right, that's part of the API, that's part of MongoJS that converts a string, right? Into an internal representation of a primary key, okay, right? So that it can compare primary keys with primary keys, okay, right? That's a part of the API. And the second one, the second argument here is that it retrieves it. Well, it's the error, same thing as here, right? The error and the data, right? Or the document, the one document that meets this criteria, right? With this object ID. And what we're going to do, we're going to do a response.json and pass back the document that we found, that one employee. Make sense? Everybody okay? All right. Okay. Let me restart the server. All right, the server started. Okay, so get employee by ID. Let's hit the service. So let's get all of them first. What was it? Was 8080? Yeah, right. And then get
all employees. There it is. Those are all of them. In a separate one, I'm going to do localhost 8080, get employee by ID, but I don't have an ID. Let me copy an ID from one of these, right? Let me maybe Bob. I'll copy that. All right, I'll come here and I'll paste the ID here. There it is, Bob Marley, right? Or if I give it Edward, I copy the ID, I can always go back and retrieve that one record. There it is, Edward Norton. Yes, I can retrieve. What about delete or update? I want to change. So we know how to do the create. Yes, we know how to get all of them. We know how to get one. We're still missing two, right? We want to be able to update, and we want to be able to delete, right? So let's do delete. So we can delete a couple of these Charlies, right? Let's delete a couple of these Charlies. So let's make another app here. I'm going to say app dot get. We'll say remove employee by ID. So again, I'm going to pass an ID, right? And then you're going to remove it. You're going to remove it. So say function request response. And we want to retrieve the ID from the parameters. We have the ID right there. So to delete, let's go back to our MongoJS. Find remove, there it is. Fully half remove. Okay, so in here we're gonna say we're gonna copy paste db.collection. The collection is what? Employees, right? So employees, the query is I need to be able to filter it. So the filtering is very similar to here. And there's a filter. I'm going to put it here. This is optional. Whether if several match, right? Whether you want to just delete the first one or you want to delete all of them. Okay. I'm going to remove that. And the callback is the function. So this same function. So I'm going to copy that function. The function and paste it here. Let's see. Da-da-da, remove, blah, 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 error doc. Okay. I don't remember. I don't know what kind of document would it return since it's removing it. Let's see. I'm going to save that. I'll restart the server. Okay. Let me go back here. And we had get employee by ID. Let's remove a couple, right? Let's remove, let's see, a couple of Charlies. Let's remove this Charlie over here. So what did I map it to? Remove employee by ID. Okay, so remove employee by ID. Oops. Remove employee by ID and then the ID. ID is not defined, blah, 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 blah. Oh, I said ID. It's really what? Request.params.id, right? It's in the parameters, correct? Let me restart the server again. Let me refresh. There it is. Okay, so, all right, so probably what comes back, okay, what comes back is an object that represents how many records were affected, right? So one of them was affected. Let's see if I do that again, it comes back with zero, right? It didn't find it anymore. Right, so let's try and delete a couple more. So presumably that one's not there. Let's remove maybe this one. One was affected. Let's remove another one. That one. Okay. If we go to the client and we ask again for all of them, notice that it's shorter. The list is a little bit shorter. All right, let's remove a couple more. That one, did we do this one already? Yeah, we had done that already. What else? Let's remove a couple more. Actually, we can remove them by last name. How's that? Let's remove them by last name. So remove all of them, okay? So we can say here, we can copy this, paste it, and it says remove employee by last name, right? And this would be last name, right? And so this is, we're gonna filter by last name, right? So it's gonna remove here, it says last, right? Because that's the attribute in the record, right? The attributes in the record are last, not last name, right? Last name is what I'm calling it, the mapping, right? The way I'm mapping it. And over here, last is gonna be from where? From requests dot params, whatever I called it in the path, I called it last name. So wherever last attribute matches the last name in the query string. Yes? In the path parameters. Everybody okay? Right? And maybe I should say true, meaning I want all of them gone. Right? I believe the default is false, meaning I will only remove the first one, but not all of them. So let's start again. Let's start the server again. Okay. And at the query here, I'm going to say remove by last name. And the last name is Garcia. Just one. Oh, maybe it's supposed to be false then. Okay, we still have a couple Garcias. Let's try the false here, false. Okay, let's try it again. Okay, five were removed. All right, five were removed. If I go to my database and I do a query, there are no more Garcias. Okay, how about updates? Let's update a couple. Update the so we did what? We did create, we did find all, find one, delete by ID and delete by last name, right? Whatever criteria you might want. Now let's do an update, right? Let's do an update. So let's do here an update. So I'll say the update is very similar to the create, right? It's very similar to the create. Where's the create? Some JSON get all employees, get, remove, create. Oh, there it is. So the update is very similar, right? In that we have to pass the new values that we want, right? The new values that we want to change the salary, right? I guess the only thing we can change, right? We can't change the first name, can't change the last name. We'll change the salary, okay? So we have to pass that information. Presumably we're gonna change this to salary. And instead of an insert, we're gonna do an update. Okay. But we kind of have to like find the record, the original record, right? We have to find the original record by ID, yes, and then do the modifications, right? So somehow we need to also not only pass the data, we also have to pass the ID. No, we also have to pass the ID. So that's okay. So the ID, notice that over here we're using queries. So we're going to copy this. Let's use query again for updates. So we're going to say, you can use either one. Actually, you can use a combination, right? You can do path, right, and some queries. Right? So you can do a combination of both. Right, so here we're create employee. We're going to do an update employee of the employee, and then we're going to pass the ID here, and the new pieces of data we're going to pass it as query parameters. Right? Presumably we're not going to pass first name and last name, right? Because we can't change those. So presumably the only thing we're going to pass is the salary. Okay. So we're not going to do that. So we're going to create maybe a variable, local variable salary equal to the salary that we are getting from the client. And we have to do a find and modify. So let's do that. Let's find it here in our MongoJS. Find and modify. There it is. So let's query. Let's copy that. And let's let's paste that in here. Okay. So you know, my collection, what's the collection? Employees, right? And the query is that I need to find it by ID, right? So my attribute that I'm going to filter on is by ID. That's what I have, right? And over here, I'm going to need a new object ID. So it's a mongojs.objectID, right? And pass it as an argument, the ID, which I'm getting from where? From the parameter, right? So this is going to be request.params.id, right? So I'm going to filter it. Now I have the object that I want to modify. I found it. Yeah? What I want to do, I want to change certain things, right? I want to set, here's the update statement. I want to set it's the salary to the new salary. That's the field, right, that I want to modify, and that's the new value, the salary that I got from here. Or I could just copy from here, right? I can just paste it here, and I don't need this variable. Okay. And new true. Okay, all right, so this, there is also a feature that you can do in what's called an upsert, right? An upsert means if you find it, update it, right? If you do not find it, insert it, okay? For insertion, we would need everything else, right? We would need the first name, last, we're not providing it, right? So we're not gonna use that that feature, but it's there. And what we're going to do is that we're going to return, what should we return? Maybe we could return the new object, right? So here's doc, we're going to return that. So we're going to say response.json, and we pass in the new document that was updated, right? The way it is right now with the new salary, okay? If that comes back, then we have an acknowledgement in the database, right? So we should render the UI, right? The UI should always reflect whatever's in the database, right? You should not render the UI, right? It says, oh, change the salary, even though you know that you don't know yet whether the salary has been successfully updated, right? Something could have gone wrong, right? And so you'll be reflecting something that is in the UI that is not true, okay? Okay, so let's try that. So we're passing the salary as the query. Okay, so let's see. So presumably we have, let's restart the server. Let's restart the server. And here we're going to do, what's the name? It's, what is it? What's it called? Update employee. So update employee. And it's expecting an ID, all right? So let's retrieve all of them, get all employees. There they are. We have three employees, or four. Let's see, we have Alice, Bob, Dan, and Edward, okay? So let's change Alice's salary, all right? So let's take her ID and make it the ID here, okay? And then we're gonna provide a new salary, right? As a query parameter, so salary equal, she makes a really big bucks. Right, so we hit it, there it is. So it came back and it did not change. What happened? Let me see. Did it change? Alice. Oh yeah, it did change. It did change. So what did it come back? What did it come back? Error, less error object, response doc. It's coming back with the initial, it's coming back with the object that it found, right? That object that it found, that I am going to modify this object. Okay, all right, whatever. Something that is common, some people find it a good idea is to, for instance, I've updated, right? Oftentimes, to update something, probably you went to some kind of detail page, right, where you updated a record, right? And then when you said okay, typically you either, well, you have two options, right? You either stay in the update page, right, details page, or, right, the other option is that to go back, right, to a previous page where you came from, right? Typically, that previous page is perhaps the list of all employees, right? Maybe you had the list of all employees, you click on an employee, you're looking at that record, that particular employee, right? And you want to update it, so you hit the new salary, right? When you say save, typically, one option is to go back to the previous page, right? With the updated values, right? So for instance, if you updated the salary, well, then you show that one that has been updated. There's two ways. One is either you cache everything and you update that one record in your JavaScript cache, right? Or you re-query the database, right? And you respond with the new records to show a list. Obviously, not all the lists, right? Typically, it's a paginated list, right? You have thousands of records. Perhaps you're showing 10 at a time, right? So you will return the 10 that you were last looking at before you came to the update page, right? Okay. Yeah, that makes sense, right? So we have update employee. Yeah. All right. So what else? What else? Let's see. Yes. I'm sorry. I would do a query again for the same object. I would do a query, just like it did a respond, get employee by ID. Yeah, no. So what I wanted to show you is being able to. I want to be able to show how you could return all of them. Where is it? Where'd it go? Is this it? This is the one we were looking at, right? So let me show you. Where is it? I copied it. So for instance, if I copy this here, you can nest it. And that's one thing I want to point out is that you have to nest these. For instance, you have a relationship between one record and another record, right? And for instance, I want to remove this. Well, what about all the other records that depend on that one record, right? How do I update those, right? You have to, for instance, put it nested because these are asynchronous, right? You don't know that you have updated yet, right? Until this function gets called, right? This function notifies you that yes, the update has gone through, right? Or maybe the delete. Say you delete an employee. You don't know that the record has actually been deleted until this function gets called, right? So for instance, when would you refresh the page? How would you know, right? Because right, if you go back and it has been removed, what do you do? Do you show the, even though you don't know if the server has actually removed it, are you going to remove it locally from your cache in JavaScript? You shouldn't, right? Because you don't know if it's actually been removed, right? So this would be a good place to put it. So there it is. So this is what I wanted to point out, that I am nesting here, and employees get all the employees, and I'm responding with all the employees. So let's do that. Let's update again. Let me update her salary. She's got a 10% increase. Okay, so there it is, right? So notice now I have all the records, right? Including the record that Alice has been modified with her new salary, plus all the other ones. So I could use this to refresh, right? My page, my summary page, listing the list of employees. Okay, one last thing before we go. So we haven't made the changes here that we need for this to work in MongoDB. Okay, in MongoDB in the remote server, right? In the remote server, we did copy a couple of things here that we have a MongoDB a URL connection URL. This is almost what we need, okay? But one way that we can be sure that it's the correct one, we can create here app.get. I'm going to create here an environment query to tell us what are all the configurations. It is very similar if you do PHP init, right? It gives you all the configuration of the PHP engine. I'm going to respond here, JSON, with process env. Where's process env? There it is, process env. I want to see all the environment variables, including the URL that we're going to need for MongoDB in the remote server. So let's paste that in here. Let's restart this. Restart the server. So locally, nothing should happen. But if I do an env, so this is all the local environment variables. Obviously, we don't have any OpenShift things in here. Okay, there's nothing OpenShift. But when I push it to my OpenShift, I am going to be able to see the environment variables for OpenShift. Okay, so let's push it. We're going to say git add anything that is new. What's new here? MongoJS, right? That library we never added, so we're going to add that. And we're going to do a commit. MongoJS, and we're going to do a push. That's going to restart my server. And we have to get going. The other teacher got mad at me that we stay a little longer. Come on. Okay. And where is it? Okay, it's this one, right? If we look at the environment, env. Okay, there it is. So these environment variables, here's the username, the password is here, the URL, where's the URL? MongoJS URL, where are you? URL, there it is. This is the URL that we're going to use, right, to connect to the remote MongoDB instance, right? And we're gonna have to leave it till Wednesday, all right? But I'm gonna put this on GitHub so that you can play around with this, so you can create your own, right? And also, this is obviously it's being recorded, and so I'll send the link to the recording so you can follow along. All right, thank you.